Hey, it's Chris. Apple just announced a bunch of cool stuff, including a credit card, which of course the haters jumped all over. But in this video, I'm gonna tell you why they're wrong, and I'm also gonna give you my take on all of Apple's new services. So check out the description for some timestamps. Just real quick, YouTube is notoriously bad at notifying subscribers of new content. So if you wanna know when we publish new content for sure, and a lot of you have sadly been missing out, then you can sign up for the brand new DailyTekk alerts down in the description. So let's talk about the Apple Card first. I've seen several news outlets and journalists downplaying the Apple Card. And most of the criticism seems to say that the Apple Card doesn't offer unique rewards or perks. Essentially, the big complaint I've seen is people saying, cash back? What's the big deal? There's been cashback cards forever. This is really nothing new. It's just a typical card. And that, my friends, I feel like deserves a giant facepalm. I'm about to tell you why this card is anything but typical. Hey, let me just jump in really quick before you learn about why the Apple Card is so awesome to tell you why today's sponsor, Skillshare, is also awesome. Skillshare is an online learning community for creators with more than 25,000 classes in design, business, technology, and more. So if you're like me and you want to continue fueling your curiosity, your creativity, or even your career, then a premium membership might be perfect for you since it lets you join the classes and communities that can make your 2019 a success. There's a lot of classes that I'm interested in personally, ranging from cinematography to photography to data science to analytics, and I've really been enjoying lately this course called DSLR Filmmaking from Beginner to Pro. Skillshare is super affordable at less than $10 per month, so if you're interested in joining the more than 7 million people who are already learning online with Skillshare, then check out the link down in the description. By the way, the first 500 people to sign up using that link are gonna get 2 months to try it out for free. Let's get back into it. In case you're curious why we're talking about the Apple Card first, when Apple also announced a gaming subscription, a news subscription, and a Netflix competitor, well, of all those things, people seem to be the most interested in the Apple Card right now. Why? Is it because it's the only hardware that Apple announced at the event yesterday? Maybe. Was it because it gave more cash back, more privacy, and more titanium than people usually get? Maybe. Was it the fact that buying new Apple hardware with this card could largely pay for all of Apple's new services thanks to the cash back? Or the fact that you can now get cash back on iCloud storage? Maybe. It's probably a bit of a mix of all those things, plus the fact that it's kind of an unexpected Apple product. It's not confusing, it's simple, it's secure, it's private, you apply on your phone, it's a new status symbol, and it just looks different than other cards. So yeah, there's a lot that's different about this card. The last thing in the world that I would call it is typical. In fact, there's several reasons why some people are calling it a game changer and why people on Wall Street may not understand average Apple consumers might want it. So yeah, there are other cash reward cards out there, but the Apple Card pays out rewards daily in a feature it calls Daily Cash. DailyTekk, Daily Cash. Obviously, I like that. I mean, if I go to the Apple Store and buy a $1,000 phone, I just made 30 bucks, and I don't have to wait a month to hit some minimum payout. I can just head straight to Starbucks and celebrate right then. Not so typical. So you get 2% cash back anywhere that takes Apple Pay, 1% cash back if you use the physical card, and 3% for any Apple purchases. Any Apple purchases, including services. Now, I don't care about travel miles like some people do. I do care about 3% back on Apple purchases. And then let's talk about the app, which is also not typical. What other credit card, cashback or not, has an app like this? It's easy to understand and it demystifies payments. Is it typical? No, it's not. It's just funny how people have been covering this. Like Wired tried to phrase it like Apple's late to the game with this app, like Mint could already break down your financials for you, which is another facepalm. Apple's app puts everything all in one place. Oh, and it's private. With the Apple Card, you can make monthly payments to reduce interest. Pretty cool. And being able to see how your payment amount changes the interest you pay, pretty cool. Definitely, absolutely, positively not typical. One area where maybe I was more excited than most people, I don't know, was the text messaging support. I hate calling companies. 99% of the time, it's always terrible. So texting without having to answer a bunch of security questions? This is like VIP territory in comparison to cards that are actually typical. So Apple says no fees, which is great. If you happen to go over your limit, no penalty fees. Now, I'm not a financial industry expert, so I can't tell you if that's typical or not, but I can tell you as a consumer that it sounds cool and I'll take it. If Apple made one thing clear during this event, it was that they're serious about privacy and that you can live a more private digital life in Apple world. Now, security and bugs, those are things that all tech companies have to deal with, but all tech companies also choose whether or not to share or sell or otherwise profit from your data. And that, unfortunately, is a practice that I would call typical within the tech industry, except Apple's card doesn't do that. So the Apple card, again, is not typical. Apple's not even gonna know what you bought with their card. And Goldman Sachs, the bank that's behind the card, also isn't gonna share or sell your info. I mean, any number of these features could be called killer features all on their own. But this one is pretty major. So yes, the Apple Card is a cashback card, and yeah, there are other cashback cards, but the fact that it's a cashback card is hardly the thing that is supposed to make the Apple Card unique, as you now know. But even aside from the card's actual features and conveniences, there are two other things that make it really awesome. First, if demand for this card is high, and it looks like it's gonna be high, then more retailers are gonna start accepting Apple Pay, which is one of my favorite Apple things in the world. It was a big deal recently for me when Target started accepting Apple Pay because they were the main big retailer holdout. So now that Target's doing that, I can go out of the house and basically purchase everything, including gas, on my Apple Watch. So adding extra retailers till we get to the point where basically everybody accepts Apple Pay is going to be a huge upgrade, and this card might help us get there. Second though, and this is also very important, the Apple Card might push other credit card companies to be a little less scummy, because maybe they'll have to if they want to compete. Probably not, who are we kidding? But it is a nice thought. Here's the thing, the Apple ecosystem is really turning into a legitimate haven. Now, is the Apple Card all sunshine and rainbows and the best thing that ever happened ever? That I'm not saying. There's still a couple questions that it would be great to get some answers to. Credit cards can be used poorly or improperly. So is it a good thing that even if they're doing it in a less scummy way, Apple is encouraging people to spend money that they potentially don't have? Another question is, what happens to your cashback rewards if you end up making a return? So let me give you some of my impressions about the other services that Apple just launched, starting with Apple News Plus, because it's the one thing that's actually available now, and I'm thinking about making a full-on review of this. So if that's something that you want to see, be sure to let me know. The biggest thing that I wanted here was full access to the Wall Street Journal. But in reality, it's just a very small selection of the journal's content. Emphasis on small. And it's all just general interest articles. Like, from what I've seen so far, it's not even worth mentioning the Wall Street Journal as a feature. One question I legitimately have about this service is, what's the point of arbitrarily collecting articles or stories into magazines these days? Is it really just about collecting higher quality journalism and storytelling into the same container? Is it really just about letting editors tell you what's worth your time? Some of the magazines in News Plus get moving or live covers, which really isn't that big of a deal in my mind, and only a handful of covers move right now anyways. And I'm pretty disappointed to find that there are ads behind the paywall. On the web, you can pay to go ad-free on sites. Here you pay and you still get ads. True, the ads don't track you, but they're still ads. Let's talk about Apple Arcade next, which after the Apple Card, I think might have been the next most interesting announcement, at least to me. Every company seems to be getting into games, and it's kind of cool that there's so many different takes. Nintendo Switch is totally different than Google's Stadia, which is also totally different from Apple Arcade. My first thought here is that it's awesome that these games aren't just confined to iOS. I really like that they're gonna be playable on the Mac and on the Apple TV as well. Especially on the Apple TV though. It's got so much potential when it comes to gaming, and so far, it's been really underutilized. Now, this isn't a new Apple gaming console like so many people have dreamed about, but it is a start in the right direction. It's awesome to see exclusive games that are only for Apple Arcade, only for the Apple universe. And some actually look pretty decent too. I say decent because nothing looked like an absolute runaway hit like you'd find on an actual console, but again, lots of potential. The Pathless, I think, looks kind of interesting, and Oceanhorn 2 should be fairly fun. Both kind of have Zelda vibes. And the idea of diving in and discovering what the other 98 games at launch are about is also awesome. So Apple TV Plus, I think, actually sounds pretty interesting. I say sounds because there wasn't a lot to look at the event. It was just people talking about stuff. Now, I don't think that Apple has to kill Netflix for this to be successful. You have to remember, Netflix started out small, and then they grew slowly. And Apple TV Plus is likely to do the exact same thing. Of course, it's not gonna be Netflix on day one. I'm very curious, though, if Apple's original content is gonna be in 4K, and if it's gonna have Dolby Vision, and if it's gonna have surround audio. Now, personally, and we may differ here, but I like that Apple is taking a more family-friendly approach to their original content, where there's much less gratuitous sex and violence. There's what seems like 1,000 places to find that kind of over-the-top content already. So what Apple's doing is actually fairly original, and it's a great opportunity to tell good, interesting stories well that stand on their own two legs without using the M rating as a crutch. Now let's completely change directions and talk a little bit about why Apple moving into services in a big way is great for consumers and horrible for its competition. Non-Apple phones are starting to get some legitimately interesting features. Lots of extra cameras and better cameras, foldable screens, although they're not quite ready for prime time, free cloud storage for photos, and really the list could keep going. So when it comes to hardware and innovation, is Apple starting to fall behind everybody else? Well, the answer I think is no, and here's why I think that. Apple's hard at work on Apple AR glasses, whatever that's gonna be called. And when those come out and you have augmented reality just sitting on your face and you don't even need a phone to interact with all kinds of stuff, to get a 100-inch TV screen, let's say, in front of your eyes or whatever comes down the line on this platform, foldable phones and lots of different cameras are gonna be a little bit less interesting. But what Apple is really doing with its services is essentially upgrading all iPhones, all Apple devices in non-hardware ways. They're bringing new features to the devices that people already own with no need to even buy new hardware. So you can buy a non-Apple phone with more cameras or a foldable display or an in-screen fingerprint reader or stylus, but you can't get Apple Arcade there with 100 plus exclusive games. Now, some of Apple's services aren't gonna require Apple devices. Apple TV Plus is coming to all the major smart TVs and even to Roku and Fire TV. But guess what? If non-Apple customers end up sampling some of those Apple services and they like what they find, they may end up buying into Apple's hardware part of the ecosystem, iPhones and all. The truth is, Samsung and Google and Huawei and other companies have been trying to replicate Apple's ecosystem. They've been putting out phones and watches and TV streaming boxes and tablets, all with varying levels of success. But now they also have to compete with Apple's services. Well, that's gonna do it for today's show, but I would really love to know your thoughts on all of Apple's new services and the new Apple, so to speak. So obviously you can leave me a comment or hit me up on Twitter, on Instagram. I'm at DailyTekk, spelled Daily T-E-K-K in both of those places. And if you wanna further dive in to the services that Apple already offers, you should check out my video on Apple Music or on Apple Notes. And I'll link up both of those down in the description. Otherwise, I'll catch you in the next one. Later.